You're listening to the Belly Dance Geek Clubhouse at bellydancegeek.com. Hello, everybody. I'm Nadira Jamal, the Belly Dance Geek, and welcome to episode 48 of the Belly Dance Geek Clubhouse. By the month, it's not quite true, but by the episode, this makes this our fourth year anniversary, so I'm excited. The Belly Dance Geek Clubhouse is a place where belly dancers can get together and geek out on all of those things that are hard to get in classes and on DVDs. If you want help with the what, so things like moves, combinations, choreographies, technique, that's really easy to find. But if you want help with the why and the how, so things like culture, musicality, business, professionalism, that can be a little bit trickier to find. So every month I interview a different guest expert on a different geeky topic, and we always have time for question and answer so you can geek out too. If you think knowledge and creativity go together like chocolate and peanut butter, you are in the right place. My guest tonight is Dawn Devine, also known as Devina. She's a well-known author and costume designer located in Silicon Valley, California, right in the heart of the Bay Area's vibrant dance scene. She's published a collection of books, including the best-selling Embellished Bras and the seminal book on a suit called The Cloth of Egypt. In 2016, she published two books, Zills, Music on Your Fingertips, and Becoming a Belly Dancer, From Student to Stage, which she co-wrote with Sarah Shrapnel, Poppy Maya, and photographer Alicia Westerfeld. You can check her out at devina.us, that's www.davina.us, and I hope you will. So let's jump right in. So welcome!
Hello there. Thank you for having me.
I'm so excited to have you. You know, I mentioned this when we were emailing to prep for this, but I made my very first costume using your books. So I'm really, really thrilled to have you here.
Well, thank you for buying me lunch. If you bought one of my books, you bought me lunch. If you bought
awesome.
Two, I got coffee with it.
Nice. All right. So first off, would you like to be called Dawn or Devina tonight?
Well, so I ordinarily, when I'm in person, say, if I'm wearing eyeliner, I'm Devina. If I have no eyeliner on, I'm Dawn. And since this is a telephone interview, you can guess what I am today.
No eyeliner?
Dawn. No eyeliner. Not today.
All right. So everybody, Dawn is going to talk to us about the history and manufacture of finger cymbals. But before we jump right in, can you tell us your origin story? How did you get started in belly dance?
So I've been belly dancing since before the turn of the century. Yeah, I started in 1984, and I danced primarily in San Diego. That's where I had my professional career, and I performed in mostly Greek restaurants throughout the greater San Diego area from 1985 to 1996. At that point, I went to graduate school at UC Davis to study art history, and stepped down into that sort of hobbyist category. And I've been teaching belly dance since 91 and writing books since 93.
Awesome. And what got you interested in the history of Zills?
So I'm an art historian by academic training. And I wrote a major research paper when I was in graduate school called With Arms Held High, The Trope of the Dancer, Middle Eastern Art. But doesn't that sound like a graduate school paper for you? And what I did was I traced this relationship between the pose of the dancer versus the pose of an ordinary woman. So you could instantly tell when a dancer appeared in art by her pose. And Orientalist painters weren't looking at actual dancers. They were making things up as they went along most of the time. So there are a few exceptions that really took a moment to look at dancers. Well, within that paper, I talked about the presence of finger cymbals and how they're one of the oldest, most traceable components of Middle Eastern belly dance, because, you know, our costumes fade, we don't have a lot of written record, our oral traditions are, you know, sometimes very mythic and heroic in origin. We really don't know what our danced and ancestors were doing more than 150 years ago, before the advent of photography and certainly before movies came about. But one thing we do know is that they played zills. They played finger cymbals, sagat, no matter what you want to call them. They were making finger cymbals. They reach back into the distant prehistory.
All right. So the first question, I'd love to ask us of people with actual research backgrounds is, how do we know about the history of zills? Where do we get this information from?
Well, so if you are, well, so my, because my practical knowledge is in the world of art history, I look at imagery related to, whatever I'm happen to be studying. Orientalism is one of my main themes, and you study the imagery there. They can be read, just like hieroglyphics could be read by Egyptians. Orientalist paintings can be read by a trained art historian, so we can look for cultural and social and economic clues based on what the interiors included, what features were there, whether there are multiples of the same image by the same artist, et cetera, et cetera. In order, when I started doing the research on finger cymbals in particular, I had to leave the realm of art history and go back even further into pre-literate human civilization. And I started looking in the archaeological record. And so that's a different discipline altogether. And so I had to learn how archaeologists speak, their lingo, their taxonomy. And yeah, and so I kind of just kept pushing the envelope backwards, 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 backwards until I discovered pretty much a definitive origin point for when, within 1,000 years, definitive within 1,000 years of when finger cymbals were first produced.
And how far back do they go? Ooh.
Well, yeah, I know. Very exciting. So if you go today, if you went today to the Louvre Museum in Paris, France, there's an exhibit in their Egyptian hall that has finger cymbals, ancient bronze finger cymbals that date back to the second millennia BC. And we know that by then that was a well-developed product. And we know that because there are grave sites and burial sites all around the rim of the Mediterranean that have finger cymbals in the grave goods that go back all the way to practically the beginning of the Copper Age, the Chalcolithic period. So we're looking at about 3000 BCE.
Wow.
And there are examples of ancient finger cymbals in museums all over the world. The British Museum has some in, they're not all on exhibit, but they're available on their website. You can actually type in ancient finger cymbals and you on the British Museum site and see some of these ancient cymbals. The Louvre has some on exhibit, the Metropolitan Museum in New York, the Los Angeles Museum of Art, LACMA, the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. I've been to many museums. In fact, just this past October, I was in Bristol, and Bristol has a very interesting museum that's, it's not dedicated to any particular art or science. It's just the Communal Museum of Bristol. And they have a teeny tiny little Egyptian wing. I turned a corner, and there were finger cymbals on display. So
Cool.
it's they're all over the place, but I don't think many belly dancers think to look.
Nice. And if we go back to these very ancient times, is there any evidence for any precursors to the finger cymbal? Anything that might have led to that development?
Well, so finger cymbals fit into the group of musical instruments called cacophonic idiophones, or, I don't know, I'm bad at pronouncing that word. And but these are instruments that make their sound from the intrinsic property of the material that the instrument is made of. Think of a gong, think of wooden spoons, think of castanets. And those things that are made out of less durable materials, such as wood or bone, wouldn't survive, 3,000, 5,000, 6,000 years. So we know that finger cymbals existed as of the Copper Age, that at the very dawn of metallurgy and the birth of human civilization. But the notion that people played instruments that they clack together or hammer together or tap together, you know, predates that by forever. We just don't have any surviving examples. However, we do have, you know, modern day descendants like the castanets played in Spain by flamenco dancers, like the wooden spoons played in Anatolia and Turkey, in modern Turkey, and the bones that are played here in the American U.S., you know, in the South. People still play wooden sticks that they call bones because the ancestors were actually made of bone.
Mm. You know, that really reminds me of, you know, one thing that I'm totally blanking on where I got this from, but I remember a long time ago, you know, being told that a lot of early music was either played on the human body, so things like clapping or slapping your knees, or essentially whacking things that could easily be found in nature or easily manipulated mm-hmm. in nature, because things like stringed instruments or wood instruments, you know, were actually a lot harder to make. And so,
right.
You know, I, you know, earlier on you talked about how, you know, a lot of belly dance history is kind of mythic and heroic. And mm-hmm. while I feel like it's really important to pass on accurate information when you're giving people facts, you know, I feel like sometimes that mm-hmm. mythic piece is very helpful for making a personal connection to the dance. And so sure. I had heard that before I started belly dancing. And the first time I picked up finger cymbals, I remember thinking, people have been smacking things together to make beautiful music for a really long time.
Oh, absolutely.
And it was so inspiring.
If you think about children, 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds, toddler age children, they start banging things rhythmically, whatever they can get a hold of, whether it's a pot and a lid in the kitchen, or, you know, beating a hairbrush on their sister, you know, you know, we are intrinsically wired to make music. Children start making music before they can even talk sometimes. And so, you know, it is no stretch of the imagination to think that our ancestors were exactly the same as we are. So I would agree with that. It's a beautiful theory that completely holds water in terms of, you know, how human development, you know, in the life cycle of a person, you know, from childhood into adulthood, you know, we think of all these moments in our lives where we embrace music, enjoy music, make music. Of course, our ancestors, their brains were not wired very much differently. You know, 5,000 years ago, we were, you know, essentially the same as we are today. And so, you know, since the modern human brain has been around, I think that people have been making music with whatever they could, you know, manufacture and craft and create. And of course, you know, this advent of metallurgy, which led to the, you know, us being able to say, well, finger cymbals survive. There are musical instruments in Egyptian burials that, you know, sistrum and lyre, frames of lyres and bone clappers that exist. And things like that we know, you know, date back into deep antiquity before they had, you know, those, you know, extreme burial practices.
Now, in terms of geography, you know, you've said that they have found finger cymbals all around the Mediterranean rim. Do we know if mm-hmm. they started in one place and then spread, or if they sprung up in multiple places, or is there any evidence for finger cymbal style instruments outside of that area?
So finger cymbals start appearing in burials throughout the Near and Middle East. You know, Anatolia, modern day Turkey, seems to be a very the crucible of metallurgy and its developments, and it's spread into Europe and farther east and, you know, south into Egypt. You know, at that point in time, we're talking about people who could, you know, hop on a boat and go across the Mediterranean if they were brave. And so there was a great deal of communication and trade. This was at the very dawn of what we think of as civilization, with the start of the major cities that have, you know, are still in existence now. When we think of Istanbul, previously Constantinople, previously Byzantium, you know, we're looking at history that goes back before there was written literature, before there was written language, people were making metal. There are a few interesting places where there are, you know, the earliest moments when they know that copper was being mined and melted. For instance, around 3200 is really 3200 BCE, before the Common Era, is when they, you know, they kind of say, well, that's the Middle East. But there were a few pockets that may have been earlier in Spain, on the Iberian Peninsula. There were people experimenting with melting metal even earlier. And of course, this technology made its way all the way across to China, and they have ancient developments. But they have a different culture that developed, and so finger cymbals outside of the Mediterranean aren't really found. Part of that is that it just wasn't part of their culture. Of course, in China, you have tingsha. Are you familiar with that instrument?
Tell me about that.
So a lot of people will, I'm sure you've seen these in your mind's eye, if you can imagine, to what look like finger cymbals connected by a chain. They're used in Buddhist meditation rituals. And so they're rung. They look very much like our finger cymbals. However, they are played by hand, but it takes two hands on the chain, and then the chain is pulled and they ring against each other. And it's not really a dancing kind of music. It's a meditative, slow pace. And if you think about it, the Chinese gong and other gong-like suspended discs of metal that are banged to indicate times of the day, those are just much larger finger cymbals. They're the same technology, and so cymbals really are very ancient in their shape and their size. And it's hard to believe that it's 5,000 years old, you know, and documentably that old.
Mm-hmm. All right. You know, so thinking back to the ancient world, do we know how they were used? Do we know who played them in what kinds of settings or for what purpose? Is there any information on that at all?
So when writing really came into being, you know, and we're thinking about cuneiform writing in the Near East and the hieroglyphics of Egypt, when these earliest Phoenician, Egyptian written languages were developed, we start seeing a written record. However, that's mostly commercial, business, and legal documents. We don't really see a writing down of cultural and social information until the Egyptians really got into the habit of just putting tremendous amounts of grave goods and information into their funeral traditions. Prior to that, you know, writing existed, but it was very practical. It was very man-centric, very business-centric, legal-centric, histories, accounting. And, you know, until you get a culture that has the time for people to develop literature and the documentarians, I'm thinking of Herodotus in ancient Greece, who traveled all over the Middle East and wrote a series of epic books where he just describes the cultures and the material goods of all the places he visited, including ancient Egypt and the Near East. And you know, until he comes along, the notion of writing down a history or documenting a culture just really didn't exist. It didn't occur to anybody. So we don't have written records of how these finger cymbals may have been played. We know that they existed. We know that they were found in grave goods, which means they were important. They were made of a very expensive material. And as you know, copper can be remelted and reused. So a precious set of finger cymbals would, you know, represent a huge amount of wealth that was then not converted into future wealth. It had to, you know, it was found in these burials as these very precious things, jewelry, finger cymbals, and other precious personal items. Now, finger cymbals are found in frequently where women are buried. Mm-hmm. And so we know that they are associated with women. But other than that, we don't know how those women played them or used them, because there were no written records at that time.
And do we have any information, or did this come up in your research, about who those women were? Were there particular types of burials that had them versus others, or is that not available?
Well, so, you know, the thing about an ancient burial pre-literature is that, you know, you come across a space, let's say in Israel, and, you know, they can date things if there is using carbon-14 dating on, you know, textiles and foodstuffs that might be in jars. But other than that, there's absolutely no way to know, you know, aside from knowing this culture was in this space at this time. When there is no written record, there is no way of knowing.
Mm. And are there any clues from the other things? Like, you know, was there anything in there that implied that they might have been wealthy or otherwise?
Well, so yes. Having metal buried with you indicates wealth, undoubtedly. Mm. It depends upon what region you're in, because burial customs vary with your religious, you know, inclinations or your cultural inclinations. Mm-hmm. So in places like Egypt, for instance, where the king, you know, the pharaoh would have a tremendous amount of goods buried with him, but they weren't necessarily all his. And so there are things that were found in his, you know, in these monster burials. I mean, we think about King Tut. Not everything in his burial chamber was for his use. There were things that were for his servants to use to serve him. So he wouldn't have necessarily played a musical instrument, but they would have been included because he would have had musicians with him in the afterlife. And so that is one cultural phenomenon that we know. If we go to Anatolia and we look at some of these Anatolia burials sites, you find that these are smaller communities. There's no written language, even quite late. You'll find burials that take place in these tumuli, which are dome-like structures, and whole families would be buried in them. And you wouldn't even know necessarily which goods went with which particular person sometimes. You know, and then if you go into Roman times, you know, and, you know, moving forward, you go into Roman times in ancient Rome, a lot of people were not buried. Instead, they were cremated. And then, you know, we don't have necessarily a record of everybody who passed on and all of their goods, because they had a very different burial tradition.
Mm. Cool.
Yeah, so it's in ancient, you know, the further you go back, the less information you know. All we can do is we can look at the surviving goods and make educated guesses. And so the educated guess, you know, here are finger cymbals. They're the same size and shape as modern finger cymbals. They're made of copper, and then later on they're made of bronze. We still play bronze finger cymbals today. So if a woman has finger cymbals in her grave goods, you know, there's a good chance she either used them for a religious purpose, or she was using them for, you know, cultural reasons, like making music and dance.
All right. So it's clear that these were important to people in one way or another. And, you know, this might be getting into speculation, and that's fine. But why do you think they were so important?
Well, if metal itself is very expensive. The whole sense of having something that represented a lot of wealth in a small portable way was, you know, a very potent way of saying, well, you know, I have more status than you. Look at these instruments I have.
Big diamond engagement ring, right?
Yeah, you know it. You know it. It's and that's one of the reasons why people have a lot of jewelry. they have fine clothes. You know, it's a statement. The other reason why is because if you think about this, and this is an interesting sort of exercise to do, but if you think about it, if you're by yourself and you live out in a house out on a hillside, and you're by yourself most of the time, you don't have the internet, there's no YouTube, there's no, you know, but I think about this. The only time that you had music is when people would come together. The only time that you could dance is if a band came together or a group of people clapping, you know, or you could dance to the music in your head, of course. But if you had a pair of finger cymbals, you could dance at any time. You are in control of your destiny. So if you were an entertainer and, you know, let's say you were on the streets of the city of Ur in ancient Mesopotamia, and you were a woman who had a pair of fingers or set of finger cymbals, you could actually make money right there, right then. No band needed. You could dance. And so it represents a sort of economic power. We also know that, for instance, in the Coptic faith, which Copts are the ancient Egyptian Christians. The Coptic faith is a Christian sect that broke off from Catholicism after the Council of Nicaea, blah, 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 history. But we know that the Coptic faith, starting in about 150 to 200 AD, quite ancient, they used finger cymbals within their church practices. So we know that we know because there are Coptic writings that finger cymbals were used by the Coptic Christians in Egypt as part of their celebrations. So yeah, cool. So any way that we would use them today, ancient women would use them the same way for religious observances, for fun, for cultural exchange, you know, through music, arts, and dance, through, you know, meditative purposes, to kill time in the long hours of the day that we're not filled the way our days are filled. Hmm.
Cool. Well, stepping into, you know, the more modern era, and you can define that however you want. I know that can refer to centuries or it can refer to decades. You know, how are cymbals used today? You know, how do you see their role in more old school belly dance? What do you see as being important about their recent decline in popularity? What's changed in how they're fitting into dance and non-dance cultures?
Well, I'm going to go back a couple hundred years for that, if you don't mind.
Please.
Because we do have this pictorial history that starts in the 16th century with Europeans traveling to the Middle East and recording what they saw in documented records, in imagery, in illustrated books, and in paintings, which we now call the Orientalist movement, which wasn't a movement back then. It was just a bunch of different blokes painting different pictures. And we know that dancers were part of Middle Eastern culture that goes back to the 16th century, documentably, that dancers were primarily women. They danced completely clothed, and they wore finger cymbals when they performed. So we know all these things because there is a documentable record of images. Now, are they idealized? Yes. Did the people who were drawing and painting, the Westerners who are looking at this Eastern culture, were they getting it completely right? No. There was a lot of fantasy. There was a lot of liberties taken and a lot of misunderstandings. But ultimately, you know, some guy in Europe, you know, let's say some 17th century French painter didn't just invent finger cymbals as a thing that some far off person played. Somebody told him, or he saw it firsthand. You know, it isn't something that they made up. And so if you pull together this unconnected body of images, you can trace a 300-year arc of finger cymbal use in performance arts in the Middle East. How is it becoming less popular? Well, I mean, my personal opinion, I mean, and this is just my own two cents, is that I see the belly dance world in the past 30 years that I've been involved in it as having different ages. Because I'm an art historian, I tend to group things into eras. And I think that in the 90s and the early aughts, or, you know, the noughts, or in the first decade of this century, what we had was what I call the Shakira era, when one, you know, she was like a lightning rod of this technique and style. She brought it into the hip hop world and the popular music world, and it became a thing that, you know, informed a lot of club dancing. And those club dancers were not playing with finger cymbals. The women who wanted to learn how to dance like Shakira had no interest in finger cymbals. And it was much easier for instructors to teach this wave of hungry, I want to dance like Shakira people, without having to teach them about culture and teach them about origin and teach them the more refined esoteric, you know, things like balancing swords and playing with finger cymbals and, you know, a variety of other things that have sort of, you know, there are places where nobody uses props or everybody dances with a veil because that's what they think is the right thing. And I think that Shakira really impacted the belly dance culture in the West, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Neat. Well, I'd like to move. Well, you know, we need to hear a lot of those. And you know, I'd like to move on to our second phase, which is getting into kind of the anatomy and manufacture of cymbals. But is there anything mm-hmm. else that you wanted to say about history before we get into that?
Well, I think that there is a lot of visual historical documents that have not been discussed in the world of belly dance. There's a lot of art and that hasn't been explored, either in context of the Middle East or in context of the West looking at the Middle East. And certainly every couple of weeks I discover a new pair of ancient cymbals hiding in a museum collection. And there's lots of work that's left to be done. I sometimes think I was the first person to go back that far and look at these ancient finger cymbals, because I couldn't find any information when I wanted to, so I had to do the digging myself. Have you seen anything about ancient finger cymbals in any belly dance literature you've read?
Not that I can think of, no.
Yeah, it was this moment of sort of, oh, nobody's talking about this, but this exists. And that's one of the reasons why I wrote the book, because I really wanted to get this information out so that people could start thinking about it and doing their own research and doing their own explorations.
Yeah. I think the closest that I've heard, you know, is that I've taken a lot of workshops with Artemis Murat and also with mm-hmm. Yasmin Henkish, who are both in D.C. Mm-hmm. And I took mm-hmm. one with them several years ago that they called Vive la Difference, which was kind of a Turkish-Egyptian mm-hmm. style compare-contrast. And, you know, one of the mm-hmm. things that they've talked about is other percussion instruments going back. And so there, you know, were some evidence in prehistory of people playing clamshells as percussion instruments. And we don't know if they were played on the fingers necessarily versus kind of gripped in the palms. Mm-hmm. And there are also a lot of kind of medieval Turkic, I don't know if medieval is the right word, but, you know, centuries old miniature paintings in Turkey, particularly of dancers playing clapper instruments with two sticks.
Right. Oh, yeah. You know, and those are just you know, it's funny. Those are the predecessors to the Turkish spoons. And so you know, a lot of people haven't made that connection that those bones, and I'm going to call them bones because that's what they're called. If you wanted to buy a set here in the United States, you can look online, you can type in wooden bones instrument, and you can get a variety of dealers who sell these things. And they look exactly the same. They're the same shape because, of course, human hands are about the same shape as they were 300 years ago, 500 years ago, 2,000 years ago. And so all the way, if there's ancient Egyptian clappers made of ivory. Some of them are shaped, are cut so that they're straight, you know, rectangular, just like those bones depicted in Persian manuscript illuminations from the 16th and 17th centuries. We're looking at ancient Egyptian examples that go back to the 2nd century BCE. So, you know, so those kinds of instruments, those have been played a long time, are, I would say they run parallel with cymbals. The thing about cymbals and these metal instruments is that they resonate with that metallic sustained ring that you don't get from wood or bone or organic materials.
They're literally bells.
Yes, they're literally bells. And so I think that that once metal was invented and this form of instrument took shape, it exists in the same shape, form, and configuration for 5,000 years now. So there are many, many, many precursors in the form of clappers, but those clappers, whether they're, you know, from a bluegrass band in Appalachia today, or they're being played in Turkey, which they still are in that clapper form. They're played in England. There's a whole a tradition in Scotland of playing the bones, and they're global. They're worldwide. Because hands are all the same, because the art of manipulating bones is the same. You hold one still, you clap or you flip the, you have a loose one and a stable one. The same way you play castanets. You hold one in your palm and it stays stable, and then the outer one flips. And so it can tick kind of like a teeter-totter kind of movement. And so they're all played in a very similar way. But I wouldn't say that those, you know, while they do predate, I think that they're a totally different kind of instrument because they don't have the resonance, and they make a different kind of quality of sound. So, I think that Turkish spoons, which, you know, are the more stylized version of these ancient, for lack of a better word, bones, you know, I think that they continue to be played. And you know what? There are some great examples of people playing Turkish spoons on YouTube. Yeah, people go to Turkey and they take vacations. They're not belly dancers, just regular old people. And they've recorded and are just astonished by how amazing the quality, the variety, the precision of these spoon players. It's really phenomenal.
All right. Well, let's start talking about the manufacturing process, since we've kind of touched on a couple pieces already. But before we go too much into the nitty-gritty, why don't we talk about what a finger cymbal actually is? Can you talk about the anatomy of this instrument, what the pieces are?
Sure. So fingers, well, all cymbals are large round discs. When I say large, ignore that word. A cymbal is a metal disc that has a hole through it or a way of suspending it. It can have a loop attached to it where the whole instrument vibrates. So it's struck and it's vibrated, and it vibrates. It makes its sound from the metal vibrating. All finger cymbals are between, I would say the smallest you can effectively play is about an inch and a half, to the distance between the tip of your longest finger and the web of your thumb. So I have seen them up to 5 inches, though I have never met a person who could play 5-inch finger cymbals. There's probably a guy, he's probably in an Egyptian orchestra, and he's probably awesome.
But he probably has really big hands.
Really big hands. But in antiquity, they vary between 2 and 3 inches in diameter, and they have a curve or a slope shape. So it's not a flat disc. It's a curved shape. They've always had a curved shape. There aren't objects that are flat that they found. You know, they haven't, like in the historic record, they haven't unearthed absolutely flat finger cymbals. They have unearthed flatter than what we have now, but they always have a bit of a dome, and that's a resonance chamber or what is called a bell, and that bell impacts what the finger cymbal sounds like. Finger cymbals, generally speaking, are come in sets of four, though in antiquity they often found pairs instead of sets of four. But sets of four have also been discovered, so it's very uneven. Of course, the earliest ones were copper. The Bronze Era brought bronze. Bronze is copper and tin. It's an alloy. And then brass was invented in about the 16th, 17th centuries. During the very beginning of the Industrial Revolution, brass, the wide manufacture of brass, made brass instruments possible. You know, so if you think about a tuba being made out of brass, all of that is post the 16th century. And finger cymbals were immediately made out of brass. The Zildjian Manufacturing Company, which is the oldest family-owned company in the United States today, started in Turkey and dates back to the 16th century. And they were making finger cymbals in the 16th century, as well as big marching cymbals for bands and other metal instruments. So after the Bronze Era, then there was the Brass Era. In the 18th century, they added German silver or white metal. So when you see a pair of high quality silver zills like Sorin Pros, you know, here, the Sorin company makes silver zills. Those are made out of German silver. That's just an alloy. It actually doesn't have very much silver in it at all, if any. But it's a copper nickel combination that holds a silver color and but maintains the resonance of that copper. All of those four metals, you know, are available. Finger cymbals are available made in all four of those metals today, and those fall into a category called red metals in the world of manufacturing. So all those metals have a copper base and fall under that term. Boy, metal. We could go on all day about talking about metal. So manufacturing process is basically two ways of making finger cymbals. There's casting method, where the metal of choice is alloyed together, meaning it's melted and mixed, and then poured into a mold. And there are two companies today that still make cast metal finger cymbals, Storion that I mentioned earlier, which is located in New Jersey, and Sabian, which is in Canada. And they make what I would consider orchestral quality finger cymbals. They're really sought after and collected by high-end Western musicians. There are a couple of operas in particular that require finger cymbals. So, you know, they're made specifically for orchestral music. And there are dancers who actually prefer Zildjian cymbals because of the quality of the the bronze, because those both Zildjian and Sabian make cast bronze finger cymbals. And it's
Can I interrupt you for just a second?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. I think a second ago you said that Sabian and Soroyan were the two manufacturers. Did I mishear or did you misspeak?
I messed up. No, I totally misspeak. So Zildjian and Sabian. So the reason I'm mixed up is because Sabian and Zildjian are actually the same family. So the Zildjian company, 50 years ago had a schism in their family, and one of their sons ran away to Canada with their special metal mix, you know, the recipe to their particular alloy, and started making competing products. And Sabian and Soroyan are very similar, so I have a tendency to kind of mix them up, so I apologize.
Not a problem.
And Sabian. Sabian is owned by a member of the Zildjian family. Mm-hmm. So, confusing. It's very confusing. So Soroyan Manufacturing makes modern zills using rolled metal stock, meaning they buy metal that's already in sheet metal form, and they use post-industrial metalworking techniques using precision machining to make their finger cymbals. Now, the sheet metal stock is then it goes through a five-step process. The first step is to punch, use a punch to make the flat disc that becomes the blank for the zil, the finger cymbal. Then it is embossed with whatever pattern or design that is stamped on to the disc. The disc is then shaped over a die, and using extreme amounts of pressure, obviously, to mold these. So they're molded over. Then they're punched with the double slot. Soroyan Manufacturing uses a double slot method. And then they're polished to bring up the shine or the surface quality of the instruments. And I was actually at the Soroyan factory last August. So I got to see this whole process in action.
Neat. So, we talked... Oh, go ahead. So we've talked about, a little bit about some of the, parts of a finger cymbal and some of the different ways that they're made. How do each of these things affect the sound? Are there particular things that a dancer should look for if she likes particular things in the sound of a cymbal?
Well, so if you have a chance to try a lot of different finger cymbals, do it. I think what happens is I'm very lucky. I live in California. I was able to go to the Soroyan factory and listen to 50 different finger cymbals. Not everybody has that kind of access. But, there are members of the dance community who do amass quite sizable collections. And if you have the opportunity to listen to or play finger cymbals, I think the most important feature of a finger cymbal is that you like the way it sounds. Because if you don't like the way your finger cymbal sounds, you won't practice and you won't play.
Mm.
And I think a lot of students in the... when I was a baby dancer back in the 80s, my first pair of finger cymbals was basically costume grade, meaning they were produced to wear at Halloween for a costume, and they clanked. They didn't have any copper in them. I know this now. They didn't have any copper in them, so they didn't resonate. They just went clank, 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 clank. And so you always want to have finger cymbals that sound good to you because you won't practice and play them. The better quality finger cymbals will have a higher proportion of copper, which will create a better resonant tone. And, always buy the best quality you can afford. If you are shopping online and you can't listen to them, buy a good name brand from a reputable dealer. If you're going to Amazon and, you see a pair of Zils for $4.99, chances are they're not going to sound that great. So there's a sense of you have to look at reviews when you're online. I always tell dancers, ask somebody. So if you see somebody and you watch them dance and you love the way their finger cymbals sound, ask them what they're using. Most people want to share. Because it always feels so good. Oh, these are just my, Zildjians, or these are my Sabian Pros, or, these are my Turquoise International B-size or whatever. There are a lot of companies that make finger cymbals, that have no name on them that'll sound perfectly fine. I'm not dissing no-name cymbals, but you can trust when you're buying, I don't want to say sight unseen, but sight unheard. if you're buying a pair of finger cymbals and you haven't had a chance to hear them, then you want to buy the best quality you can afford and know that you can return them if you don't like the way they sound.
Mm. Well, while we're talking about that, what are some of the manufacturers that people should be aware of, either the kind of widely available solid quality ones or some of the lesser known specialty ones?
Well, so there's four companies that have branded finger cymbals, and I think I've already mentioned all four of them. So if you want cast, there's the Zildjian company that makes bronze and there's Sabian that makes bronze. There's a company called Camber, C-A-M-B-E-R, which sells Sabian finger cymbals, but under a different name. So they're just repackaged, and it's called Camber. And, you know, if you went into a music store that was selling Western instruments like guitars and pianos and, you know, drum kits, companies like that work with Sabian and with Zildjian because they carry drum kits and the cymbals that go with drum kits. So we're talking about instruments that are related to the things that rock and roll musicians play, the same metals. So that is the Zildjian company and the Sabian company. Some dancers don't like those finger cymbals because they have a very long sustain because of the B8 bronze. It has a lot of copper in it, 20% copper. So in the belly dance world in the United States, there are two main companies. There's Sororian Mastercrafts, which has a huge variety of finger cymbals available. They have a very good website. And on their website, you can actually hear the sound and tone of each one of their finger cymbal models. And their direct competitor is Turquoise International. And Turquoise has a smaller selection of very good quality brass finger cymbals. So Turquoise International produces brass finger cymbals that have a dome shape and a slightly flared lip with two slots. And they just come in different sizes and weights. So I think they label them A, B, and C. And I'm not exactly sure if A is smaller or C is smaller, but they have different gauges of metal and different sizes of diameter, but they're all brass. Sororian has, I believe they currently have bronze, brass, and German silver. Bronze has a longer sustain, so if you're buying finger cymbals sight unseen, if they're bronze, they will ring for a longer period of time, regardless of their shape. And the German silver will have a higher tone. So if you think about, that's the same material that piccolos and flutes are made of, German silver. So it has a higher tone intrinsic to the metal.
Huh.
Bronze is lower and longer. Brass is a little bit higher, and German silver is the highest, brightest tone. It's also the softest metal. So if you are a hardcore dancer and you're performing multiple days a week, your German silver finger cymbals will wear out faster. They will scratch easier. They will get, you know, surface damage easier because it's a softer metal.
That explains a whole lot about which Zills I have and haven't kept over the years. Everybody loves the Sororian Pros, and I think they're fabulous instruments, but I had a pair of German silver ones, and I couldn't stand them, and now I play mostly bronze Zildjians.
Yeah.
So it's pretty much the opposite end of the spectrum.
and so different people like a different tone. Some people really like a high bell-like tone. Some people like a short sustain. Some people like to have that droning sustain. And then there are people like Morocco of New York who plays four different finger cymbals. And she creates a cocktail from four different, she composes her sound with different tones and different metals. So she will sometimes play with four finger cymbals from four different sets.
Neat.
Yeah. It's fascinating. And it does change the sound. And since she's a super high-end finger cymbal player, you know, she can do triplets and quads, and, you know, in the middle of her basic patterns. Since her right hand and her left hand really play different parts of the music, having different finger cymbals can really change it up. So, for instance, you know, she can play a drone with one hand while her dominant hand is playing a melody line. And it can sound like two people are playing finger cymbals because it's because they've got different tones.
Neat.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, you know, one of the biggest questions that comes up a lot when people are talking about zills is, what's the deal with slots versus holes? I know when I was a newbie, I was told, absolutely do not get holed zills. They are cheap crap. And then as I started getting really serious and studying with some of the masters, I realized that most of them were playing single hold zills that were definitely not cheap crap.
Yeah. Well, so this question didn't exist 20 years ago. It's very interesting to me. This question really has come up with the real focus on Egyptian technique and style. And because so many people have been going to Egypt and studying in Egypt, and there's this focus on Egypt within our greater belly dance community, we now have greater access to the kinds of finger cymbals that Egyptian musicians use. And they prefer, in their technique, hold finger cymbals. Now, this is, I'll get back to this in a moment, but they prefer hold finger cymbals because of the wobble. Because that wobble is used to make several different tones that you can't make with a slot. Slotted finger cymbals have a much clearer, crisper sound. But it's a fallacy when people say, well, hold zills are Egyptian zagat, and zills have slots. That's actually a fallacy, because all zills, all finger cymbals, all zagat, were all hold varieties for the entire length of history until the Industrial Revolution, until machinery was able to punch slots instead of casting with a casting rod to get that hole. So the slot, the notion of the slot, is a post-Industrial Revolution thing. It's a modern thing. It's the last 100 years. And so Egyptians who play sagat's just the Egyptian Arabic word for finger cymbals. Sagat doesn't mean hole. So that's the style that's preferred by that culture and for their particular musical style, right? Here in the United States, where most people have access to slotted finger cymbals, like Saroyans, the more people have bought and traded and used these slotted finger cymbals. It's easier to teach newbies with slots because they don't wobble as much. They're easier to control the sound and the tone. So I always think of it as slots are modern, holes are more ancient, it's an older quality, and it's a cultural preference whether you use finger cymbals with holes, finger cymbals with slots. I think it's all about what you learn and what you know. It's no different than somebody who plays a Gibson guitar versus some other brand. You know, they're all playing a guitar. It's just a different kind of tone and quality and style based on the different companies who manufacture it for different kinds of music.
Seems to me that that also has a very big impact on hand positioning, since if you've got kind of that 360 degree wobble, you have to hold your hands differently than if you have essentially a two-dimensional wobble. Is there any role in, you know, who's dancing versus who's sitting in an orchestra and playing?
Well, so I think that from my experience, which is, you know, I've never been to Egypt. I'll be the first person to say I can't say I've sat and listened to 30 Egyptian bands and have watched the finger cymbal players. But what I have noticed in watching a metric blort load of YouTube videos is that you see men playing larger finger cymbals. They're not dancing with it, so they're holding them in a variety of ways. You'll see them holding them vertically, or you'll see them holding them horizontally, depending upon the quality of the tone they want for that particular sound. So there's no one way to play them the right way. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I think it's all about a musician's particular technique and style and what he prefers in his sound. Finger cymbals played by dancers tend to be smaller, whether they're slotted or with holes. because they have to be able to move. We have to be able to move our arms in circles and squares and triangles and all every other position, undulating, flowing. And as far as holding our finger cymbals, it's all about who we studied with, you know, who we studied with, who we've learned, because we're going to learn that, and then how much practice you've had. Because I've really noticed the difference between somebody who really plays a lot, right, like somebody who plays daily or is performing 4 or 5 times a week, you know, will have much more fluidity and be able to make any tone from any position, right? So I think practice eliminates that, you know what I mean? So when you say, well, when you've got this wobble, you know, you can play that wobble in any position you can if you're skillful. And so it's about practice and mastery over the instrument. I think that it's easier to master slotted instruments, but you get more tonal variations from single hold wobbles, wobbly finger cymbals, staccato.
Cool. All right. Go ahead.
I always tell people it's practice, not magic.
And it's variety practice too. If you're always sitting down or standing in the same position and you don't move your hands around, it's going to be the same kind of practice every time.
Exactly. Mm.
All right. Believe it or not, we've been talking for an hour. Doesn't it feel like 20 minutes?
Yeah, I believe it. Yeah, I talk a lot.
I like that, though. No, that's usually when the calls go well. So I do want to move on to our questions and answers shortly, but is there anything that I didn't ask you about that you'd like to talk about?
Well, I do want to talk about my book for just a second.
Oh, please.
My book is called Zill's Music on Your Fingertips, All About Finger Cymbals. I chose the word Zill at the top. People have asked me why Zills and not Zagat. Well, I was trained by a Turkish dancer. I dance primarily in Greek restaurants where they're called Zills. And so that is the word of my professional belly dance career. That's not a slight against Egyptians. It's just the word I choose because, of course, Zill and Sagat finger cymbals are all interchangeable. The book is available on Amazon.com or on my website, which you mentioned earlier in the program. And, yeah, I wrote it because I wanted to share my love for these instruments with everybody I could, not just my handful of students. So I hope that you like it and enjoy it, and lots of people buy it.
And I got a sneak peek into it, and it's good stuff. It's good stuff. It's got a lot of the history of manufacture stuff that we talked about, as well as more. But then you also get into a lot more of the, you know, nitty gritty of how to play and move and how to work with the music. And so I highly recommend it.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm very proud of the book. Thank you.
My pleasure. And, you know, if people take one thing away from this call, if there's, you know, one big takeaway that they take with them into their dance career, what would you want that to be?
Oh my goodness. one thing. Let's just still.
You can have two if you really want.
Okay. I'm going to make one big giant run on sentence with lots of commas. Buy finger cymbals that sound beautiful to your ear and play them as much as you can. And study with every master, you know, workshops with different people to get different points of view. Watch a lot of orchestras and dancers. The internet has provided us with an unlimited supply of videos now and back in time all around the world. So you can see the masters of our craft performing. Watch how they hold their hands. Watch how they attack their play, because I think attack is really important when it comes to finger cymbals. And keep your thumbs still, you know, don't, you know, bring your fingers down to meet your thumbs, you know, think hammer and anvil and you know, more successful finger cymbal playing. That's it.
Oh, all right.
Is that enough? That's enough, yeah.
I think that's
I never
good.
Really talked about playing, but yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to open it up to questions and answers now. So if there's anybody who is just listening on the webcast, if you look on the right-hand side of your screen, there should be a little icon that looks like a speech bubble with three dots in it, and you can type in a question there. If you would rather ask your question with your voice, you can press star to unmute yourself. So that's true if you're by phone or if you're on Skype, you can do that on your Skype keypad. Or if you're using your mic and speakers, I think there's a little microphone bubble icon that you can click on to unmute yourself. We would love to hear from you. So if you have any questions, if you want to share your favorite takeaway or your favorite Zill story, please chime in. We would love it. All right, it doesn't look like we have an immediate taker, but
I have
luckily.
scared everybody away.
All right, well, Joy says she's typed in, "I just want to say thank you," with an exclamation point, which makes me really happy.
Yay.
And then we also had a question in our Facebook group from Farha, who couldn't call in live. I'm going to read this as she wrote it, then I may add a little bit of background because I know her and I think I know what she's talking about. She says, "My question, because I'll probably be listening to the recording, is Sagat versus Zills question mark." And I know that there's been some kind of chatter in the belly dance community about whether they're totally interchangeable words, if they're different styles of the same instrument, or if they should be considered different instruments. So I would love to hear your take on that.
Well, so I kind of touched on this already, but sagat means finger cymbals. And if you go to Egypt and you shop, you really shop, you will find different shapes, different qualities of the bell, different distances, thicknesses of the rim, and you will find all of the variety that you find if you go shopping at a US belly dance show or in a European belly dance show or in a Turkish market. The thing about finger cymbals and sagat versus zills is that zills is a Turkish word and sagat is an Egyptian word. And there are sagat and zills made with one hole, because they make one-hole zills in Turkey, they make one-hole zills in Egypt. They make one-hole zills here in the United States. One-hole zills are an older type of finger cymbal. They go all the way back, to the third millennia BCE, when copper was first used to make the first finger cymbals, up until the middle of the 19th century, when heavy metal presses allowed for the stamping of clean slots into instruments. So the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City has a pair of slotted finger cymbals from 1873 in their collection. You can see it online if you look it up, if you type in finger cymbals. And the thing is that modern finger cymbals, two slotted modern, what I think of as Western finger cymbals versus authentically Turkish or authentically Egypt or Lebanese or Syrian, which all would have one hole, older models, older methodology, more traditional. But sagat just means finger cymbals, and zil just means finger cymbals. So, it's a different issue. There's two issues there. It's terminology and it's manufacturing.
I think the style that I was hearing people pushing to start labeling Sagat specifically had a more angled bell rather than a deeper curved bell and a broader, flatter rim.
So,
Ahead.
but the thing is, the thing to remember is that isn't the only kind of finger cymbal made in Egypt either. Do you know what I mean? So if everybody in Egypt, if you walked up to a normal person on the corner, street corner, and showed them a pair of finger cymbals of any kind, they would say sagat, because that is what finger cymbals means. But what people want to do is they want to say, okay, this is the one true sagat. This is the one true finger cymbal. This is the one true Egyptian style. And I think that really does a disservice to the broader Egyptian musical culture, which includes many different shapes and styles and sizes and methods of playing.
Kind of sounds like a parallel with the way that some belly dancers are using rakshaki to refer specifically to fairly modern Egyptian style belly dance when the word just means belly dance. And so
Exactly.
it has an added meaning to one audience.
And I think that terminology, because we exist in a dance art form that doesn't have a codified terminology. We're not like ballet, where a Ron de Sham is a Ron de Sham is a Ron de Sham, the worldwide, right? We live in a world of individual learning from teacher to student. We don't have a unified, codified language because the art form comes from a variety of language bases, unlike ballet, which is primarily French. Rose in France is French, right? So even in, so in Russia, they still use the French terms because that's the origin point. But because there is no one single origin point for belly dance, you know, there's the Turkish terminology, there's the Arabic terminology, there's Egyptian, which is slightly different than Arabic in other places. Mm-hmm. And there's what Americans call it, and there's people who go, okay, well, I label these moves with the names of women, like the Maya, or I'm going to use, you know, geometric forms. This is a circle. No, that's a nomi. You know, okay, well, you know, we can all debate what these words mean, but I think that it does a disservice to the community to say that there's one word that can be used, because we live in a polyglot, multicultural dance community. So I think that Egyptophiles, people who really love the Egyptian style, are really going to give precedence to the Egyptian style, and power to them. You know, that's not the style I grew up with. I grew up with a Turkish style. I use the term zils, you know, but zils is just the word for finger cymbals. They come in a lot of different shapes and styles, double slots, single holes, bronze, brass, copper, you know, there's a wide variety. And I would never just pick one style and say, well, this is Turkish. Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that's what the Egyptophiles are coming back from Egypt after going to study with the masters in Egypt. And they're coming back and saying, well, this is the one true Sagat, you know, and it doesn't ring true to me. no pun intended. It doesn't ring true to me, because I think that it does a disservice to hone in that tight. And then, you know what I mean? And by definition, there's so much exclusion happening.
Mm-hmm. And I think especially, you know, we're in this place where, you know, we're actually getting to be a fairly mature arts community at this point. You know, we're at like 50 years of American-born dancers having their own cultural community.
How about 120 years? the first belly dancers, you know, the first generation of American belly dancers really started in the 1890s in Chicago. So yeah. We're looking at 120 years. I mean, it's much older than 50, I would say. But you're right. We are at a place, and I think the globalization of information and knowledge is really making it easy to exchange ideas across intellectual platforms and across cultural divides. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, I think that the dance community is quite old, especially in the United States. When you think about people like Ruth St. Denis, who is doing, you know, her artsy interpretations of Middle Eastern dance in the 19-teens and 20s. You know, I have a book called The Dancer that was written in 1908. That has belly dance in it. So, you know, belly dance is in our community, is, you know, in the United States, is quite old.
Mm-hmm. Cool. We also have a comment from Joy, who says, mm-hmm. I think sometimes zils are thought of as a prop and not an instrument. To hear them treated mm-hmm. with the reverence they deserve is so heartening to me. Thank you.
Yeah. I think sometimes they are treated like a prop is because teachers push students to dance with them, whether they are playing them or not. And I think we've all seen the troupe that has one person who's going through the motions but not actually playing. And that's a methodology, right? I've seen people, you know, here in the Bay Area, we have this gigantic event called Rakasa. I'm sure everybody's maybe heard of it. Mm-hmm. And they have live music going on two stages all day. And there have been many a time where I've seen dancers go out with finger cymbals and not play, but the music has finger cymbals. So it creates the illusion that they're playing finger cymbals. And in those instances, the finger cymbal is definitely just a prop. So, It's an unfortunate truth that there are people who do treat it like props and not as an instrument.
All right. So I think that is going to be it for our call today. Let's make it last call for anybody who's on the call who would like to ask a question. One more time, you can press star to unmute yourself.
Yes, I did. I definitely chased everybody away.
Now we're all here, but we had a good conversation. All right. Well, thank you so much, Dawn.
Hey, you know what? I consider myself a belly dance nerd, so it's so nice to finally have a conversation with a belly dance geek. Thank you so much for inviting me on your show today, and I've had a great time, and I hope that you continue to have great success with this program.
Thank you. I'm really thrilled to have you too. All right. And thank you everybody for coming. This is the end of our call, but that doesn't mean that the conversation has to end. We've got a private Facebook group just for listeners. I'll send out an email shortly with an invitation to that. That email will also have a recording of this call. So if you're listening live right now and you want to hear this again, you can listen to that again. We'll also include a link to our feedback survey. So if you have any ideas for guests or topics that you'd like to hear from, I'd love to hear about that. And finally, the last thing that I'd like to say is that this is the come on in kind of clubhouse, not the no boys allowed kind. So if you know anybody who would like to join us, you can invite them to do that at bellydancegeek.com/clubhouse. Our next call will be coming up in late April, but the topic and the guest are still TBD. We're waiting to find out if she can do April or if we need to change the schedule, but it's going to be a good one. You're going to like it. And until next time, happy dancing. Good night, everybody. Thanks for listening. For more geek-tacular resources, visit bellydancegeek.com.